And do you see my screen? Perfect. So welcome to the Digital Circular Housing Workshop. We can say this is the second get together with IT professionals and sustainable experts from social housing organizations. The first one was organized by Diane von Herpe from Eike Hart. They focused particularly on BIM, fast food data, and circularity. Today, we're going to take a more extensive approach and look at various technologies for circularity. And then my colleague Jan Koniesko will talk about circular ecosystem innovation. Let's take a look at the program. So we will start with two presentations, and then the participants will be put into three breakout groups to discuss various aspects of those technologies. After a breakout session, we will come back to the main room and discuss the main findings from those discussions. And the entire workshop will take about an hour and 15 minutes. So before getting started, I would like to mention that my PhD research receives funding from an Interact project called CHARM. In CHARM, we're collaborating with four social housing organizations in the northwestern Europe and to develop circular building strategies. And with my research, I'm particularly focusing on the third project output of developing material exchange platforms and creation of a market ecosystems for social housing providers. Let's begin. So let's start with a why question. Why do we need a circular built? Sorry, do you really see my screen?
We can see your screen. Yeah.
Okay, cool. Sorry for interrupting. Yeah. Yeah, let's start with a why question. Why do we need a circular built environment? Because we are facing major societal, environmental, and economic challenges, and the built environment is probably the most critical sector to address some of these issues. Let me give you a few examples. So for instance, in the Netherlands, the number of homeless people is growing and estimated to be around 40,000. In addition to that, there's a big crisis in housing, and the housing shortages at the moment is 331,000. We need to build thousands of homes in the near future and to meet this demand. However, if we use the current construction methods, we won't be able to do any good for the environment because at the current linear system, the construction sector is assumed to be responsible for the 50% of the raw material use, 40% of the energy consumption, and moreover, 40% of the waste generation. So these numbers for the Netherlands. So we need to transition from a linear construction to a circular one. So then what is a circular economy, and particularly what does it mean for the construction sector? In the linear construction, we take products from the ground. We make products such as bricks, and then we make walls, we use them. Once they reach its end of life, we usually dump them, they go to the landfill. But in the case of the Netherlands, usually they are downcycled, their value is lost. Whereas in the circular construction, we aim to generate resource loops to minimize inputs and outputs in the system. We narrow the resource loops by using fewer materials and or energy when designing buildings. We aim to slow the loops by keeping products in use. For instance, repair broken windows, refurbish homes instead of demolishing them, or we use office spaces as housing by giving them a new purpose. And finally, we aim to close the resource loop by recycling or recovering. In all of these building phases, we aim to use renewable resources and create create regenerative systems. Then, why do we need digital technologies for a circular economy? When we look at the academic literature, we see there are the two important enabling functions of the technologies. The first one is the management of resource information. In order to keep buildings in products in loops, we need to know where they are located, what is their condition, if they are available to reuse, etc. This kind of information. The second one is their enabling function for the circular business models, especially the product service systems or sharing platforms. You can think of Airbnb or Uber in such sharing platforms, assets are shared. So this is another circular business model. So this is the literature that I started building. So you can see how scholars approach circular economy and digital technologies from the built environment perspective. You see that there is more going on material passports and BIM, and the other technologies are now on the other sectors are maybe more important, but I kind of try to find connections as well. This is a diagram that I started to build just last week. So it is really like in the early phase, and I try to understand how these technologies are connected. For instance, IoT and big data are complementary to each other. You know, BIM seems to be at the center of all other technologies. Hopefully next year, I'll have a better understanding of these technologies. I just wanted to show you that the scene is a little bit complex at the moment. We really need to come up with nice frameworks to understand what digital technology is needed for what circular strategy. So in the next part of my presentation, I will go through some of the technologies really fast because we have a really limited time, and try to elaborate on how they are helpful for circularity. Additive manufacturing, as we know, as 3D printing, allows us to manufacture products from 3D models or 3D model data, which can be at times very complex. In the construction sector, we usually see examples of concrete printing. Although there are many discussions about whether 3D printing is sustainable or not, some researchers highlight the potential of energy, material, and waste reduction. And since it's an on-site production, it provides some advantages for transportation and storage. And also in the concrete mixes, you can use recycled materials. And the other one is the Internet of Things. It is a term used for interconnected smart devices, which can sense, interact, communicate with each other and with their environments, and exchange data through the internet. IoT offers many possibilities for minimizing resource inputs and outputs, and also help to keep building components in use for a longer time. For instance, currently it is used for energy efficiency in buildings, smart buildings especially, by controlling indoor climate, and also for water and lighting installations to optimize the resource use. Another example is predictive maintenance, which primarily aims for detecting early signs of failure through sensor systems and prevent possible failure in the future. It is also used for monitoring and sharing assets, like in the smart office spaces. So big data analytics allows us to process large amount of data and make sense out of it. In the construction sector, this data might come from 3D, 2D drawings, BIM, IoT, or other systems throughout the life cycle of buildings. So big data analytics provides opportunities to develop data-driven decision-making for circular strategies, for instance, to prevent waste at the end of life by designing building products in the early stage for disassembly to minimize energy use, or it can be used to generate BIM integrated applications like material databases, etc. Yeah, blockchain. Blockchain is another interesting technology which is becoming a hot topic in almost all sectors. We know this technology from cryptocurrencies like Bitcoin. However, it is a new technology in the construction sector, and I myself is trying to understand this technology, how we can use it for circular built environment. In simple terms, it's a distributed ledger technology. Just think of a shared spreadsheet which contains information such as names, prices, etc. between people, and it is protected by smart codes, which makes it really hard to cheat. Every transaction between users is recorded and can be traced by anyone in the chain, and each of the transactions has a unique identity. Once the transaction is put in the chain, it is impossible to remove it. So basically, blockchain technologies provide trust, security, and transparency in the processes. In terms of circular economy, it can help to bring transparency regarding materials provenance. For instance, where it is produced, what materials are there, who are the manufacturers, etc. There are some applications in the supply chain as well. For instance, with the help of other technologies like RFID, IoT, and GPS, the materials can be traced securely and transparently throughout the supply chain. So it has applications with material passports as well. But it is so new technology for the sector. Material passport is this is the most popular technology when we talk about circularity in the built environment, especially in the Dutch context. They are basically data sets describing characteristics of the building materials and products. They give useful information about what a building or building product composed of, where it is located, where does it come from, physical or chemical properties, and sometimes guidelines for circular disassembly, etc. Several initiatives such as BAMP, European Project BAMP, developed this kind of material passports and tested. And also there are some companies like Madaster platform, which is a more extensive version. It acts like an online registry for materials and products. It gives insights about financial and circular valuation of buildings, and gives reports like toxicity or reuse potentials. If you could see on the left corner of my presentation, there's a recent report released by Alba Concepts, Madaster, and Sea Creators, I think. There must be one more organization in there. It's a really nice report about material passports. They talk about the barriers and how it can become a standard in future. I strongly recommend you to take a look at that report. And BIM, I'm not really gonna talk too much about it because everyone in this group, I think, has a lot of experience with BIM. BIM is the de facto standard for managing building data from early development until the end of life phases. So almost all technologies that I mentioned today has somehow has links with BIM. For instance, when you add more IoT, your model can become digital twin, so you can monitor almost everything in real time. And then it helps you to extend the lifetime of your systems. That's basically BIM. Digital platforms is an interesting one. The term covers a range of technologies such as online platforms, virtual marketplaces, material exchange platforms, sharing economic platforms. For instance, there are online marketplaces targeting particularly building industries such as Gebruikte Bouwmaterialen, which aims to circulate secondary building components by providing some basic information such as photos of the product, dimensions and quantity. This platform is an open access marketplace for B2B and B2C and operated by a demolition company. Another example is Excess Materials Exchange. They are more working B2B and it's a kind of matching platform. They match supply and demand of materials between companies. And what is interesting about this platform is it combines a number of digital technologies like resources, passports, material tracking and tracing devices, digital twins and blockchain. As I mentioned, Madaster is another example for the platforms. And in our charm project, there is a good example of in-company material exchange platforms. Our partner Pari Habitat has a platform called Ecosystem, where the asset managers share reclaimed materials, and then if it's needed, those materials are used in the other building projects. So today's actually question is, we have a lot of opportunities, but which of those technologies are useful for the social housing organizations? In the second part of the interactive session, we will talk about these in detail, but I would like to quickly share a research that I've done in the early this year with 19 Dutch social housing organizations. I asked them, what kind of technologies are you using at the moment? You can see in white color. And what would you use for circular projects? So it's interestingly, digital marketplaces is the highest one. Probably the reason is they don't have to invest in this, as these marketplaces are operated by other companies. But again, there are some potentials for BIM, material passports, and IoT. And I'm really curious about your opinion in the next session. So, my presentation ends here, and I will leave the floor to Jan. And if you have any questions to me, we will have more time in the breakout session. So I'm happy to answer your questions there.
Great. Thanks, Zoltan. And hi, everyone. I will also quickly share my screen. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Yeah? Okay, great. Ja, ik ga het toch in Engels doen, heb ik net bedacht. Omdat daar zijn wij wat woorden in Engels en dan is het gewoon een beetje makkelijker. En, maar later kunnen jullie dan helemaal in Nederlands discussiëren. So, my name is Jan and I'm from Germany. I'm in the final stages of my PhD at TU Delft. I will defend my thesis on 7th of January. Here you see the book. And within the last 4 years, I've looked at how businesses, mostly from a business perspective, can innovate for a circular economy. And there's a lot of discussion about product design, how products need to change. There's a lot of discussion about how business models need to change. But one of my main propositions is that circularity is a collective outcome. It's not the outcome of how one organization does business. So, you know, if people talk about circular business models, I'm not really convinced, because circularity is really the combination of different business models of different actors that somehow need to be activated in order for circularity to come about. So that's one of the main messages I want to put forward here today. What you see here on this graph is really sort of three levels of engagement that need to be there to enable circularity. So product design elements, which also includes material choice, business models, which are about, for example, housing as a service, and then ecosystem principles, which are more around coordinating social and economic exchange through digital technology in more effective ways. But also coordinating and aligning different organizations and their business models. So that's what I want to quickly talk about. Zoltan, you already mentioned quickly three of the circular strategies, and I wanted to show you this framework, and also the references are here. So if you want to look it up at some point, you can do that. So next to narrowing, which refers to using less. So if you look at this blue line here, the sort of material and energy flows, because that's what it's really about in the circular economy. Narrowing refers to using less, so that's why it becomes thinner here. And then slowing refers to using products and components longer. Closing refers to using everything that is currently wasted again. And then there is a fourth one called regenerate, that refers to using renewable material and energy, but also to regenerating biogeochemical flows. So for example, the carbon cycle or water cycle or nitrogen cycle, that's really relevant in the built industry as well, because there is a big potential, for example, for construction materials to be made from bio-based material, from renewable material, and thereby act as a carbon sink. So application of bioplastics and have a permanent carbon stock in built infrastructure is a really big one in the built industry. So regenerate is an important principle I would like to propose as well to take into account. And then there is the inform strategy here at the bottom, which basically means using data and information technology to enable these other four strategies. So if you think about smart meters at home, they can help people to use less energy in their home. So in this case, the inform strategy enables a narrowing strategy and so forth. So this is a framework to think about circular strategies, really what kinds of resource strategies can be used. And then in my research, we developed a card deck that can help organizations to use these strategies. So it's basically a collection of principles on the product level, on the business model level, and on an ecosystem level. And there is also an online version of that, and I've linked it here and happy to share the slides later on so you can check it out. It's a template on Miro, also the tool you're going to be using today. And there's a video, I also link it here in the slide, so you can watch this 7-minute video and gives quick introductions how to use this tool. So in the middle is the framework that I just mentioned. And then for each of the strategies, you see a collection of principles that you can then apply. This is not very visible here, but it's just to quickly make the point. If you want to learn more about this, then here are some free resources for you to check it out at a later point in time. But what I want to quickly talk about is this idea of ecosystem innovation. So how is that different from business model innovation? I did case research in the mobility sector on this, but it's also relevant in the construction industry, I would claim so, where I've asked, okay, what are the principles that you should follow if you want to engage in this type of innovation? Because I'm assuming that in social housing or in the construction sector, you will very quickly realize that there are many different organizations needed to organize for something. I mean, even a simple idea like a material passport really requires all different kinds of organizations to share and somehow build a common platform of data. And then the question is, how can you organize that? So there are three main areas of action, as I would call it. So the first one is about collaboration. Like, how do you collaborate with each other, the organizations that are here now on the call, but also with other organizations. And these are just a list of principles, and I've also here linked the article that you can access. And so for collaboration, I just want to highlight quickly two principles. One of them is to ensure fair value capture among involved actors. So it's always the question is, you know, when you involve different organizations, like what's in it for them? Why are they joining, and how can they capture value from this collaboration? Another important principle is to establish and maintain trust. This is often forgotten because people directly start with the content and directly discuss what they want to do. But it's really important that, that you know, in the end, it's about people, it's about humans who represent organizations. So how do you build and maintain trust among those organizations is a really important question for the success of an ecosystem collaboration. I leave it here. And again, the slides, you can have them later on because we have limited time. And I also understand you want to get active today, so I don't want to keep you too long from that. I just quickly want to mention the second area of action, which is around experimentation. This is all around trying things out. So I want to highlight two principles here. One is to design an ecosystem value proposition. You see, from a business point of view, a business always thinks about what is our value proposition. And maybe it's housing as a service, but an ecosystem value proposition takes a broader view and thinks about what's the collective outcome that we want. And then maybe in this case, if it's about circularity, it's about less waste, it's about less pollution, less emissions, and it's about high customer value. So maybe for social housing, this can be, you know, then combined with interior design. You have washing machine as a service. Maybe you have other devices in the house as a service. You have a managed energy usage. You have the construction companies that are providing the materials to build the house and so on. So what's the overall value proposition for this whole thing? And then you can think about what that might mean. And then you can test this idea in a local space. So, you know, in some cities, they make available space for experimentation with new types of buildings, with new ways of organizing housing. So how can you test ideas in a concrete local space is another a question or important principle. And then the third area of action is what I would call platformization. You see, with the rise of the internet and online platforms, they have become very important and very powerful. And some would argue even a bit too powerful, the most important platforms being Amazon, Google, Facebook, and Apple. But this idea that they follow is really an ecosystem idea. So they create online platforms that first of all datafy social and economic interactions. So they are collecting and analyzing massive amounts of data from these interactions that they enable between people, and then they monetize that data. So that's really all that platforms do. They make social and economic exchange more efficient, and they reduce transaction costs. But then one important principle here is if you also think about platformizing, building online platforms around social housing, for example, an important principle is how do you govern and manage data flows? Because in the end, a big challenge is most of the times, you know, data comes from different organizations. And then how do you govern that? How do you actually enable organizations to share their data? And then how do you manage those data flows? So that's an important principle here. And again, there are a few others that I would encourage you to check out if you're interested in the reference paper. So that's it from my side, a quick input, and I hope this was useful. I'll stop sharing, and then I leave it up to you again, Zoltan.
Thank you, Jan, for a really quick and nice overview of your research. Are there any burning questions for Jan? If there is, please go ahead. Otherwise, I'll introduce the breakout sessions. Probably, Jan, are you going to be with us during the breakout?
No, I unfortunately have to leave, but I will share my presentation slides also with contact details. If anyone wants to contact me, please feel very welcome.
Sure. If there are questions now, then it's the moment then. If there isn't, okay. Thank you very much, Jan.
Very welcome.
Feel free to leave any time you wish.
Yes, and I'm looking forward to the outcome as well. I saw your Miro template, and we can maybe reconnect later as well. So yeah. Thanks a lot for having me, Zoltan. Yeah. Take care, everyone.
Bye. Thank you. So what I will do now is to share actually my screen again. And sorry. Yeah, this is the Miro board. Sorry again. I am using double screen and it causes some problems. So I'll stop recording for the moment and then I'll continue later with designing circular buildings. Who is going to talk from the first group?
Yeah. I think it's me and Simon.
Yeah, right.
That are going to do the recap of this. Of course, there's on the first part, which actors are involved, there's a lot of different, a lot of actors could be involved, but I think most importantly, the architect, the owner, and where we talked a lot about was the circular platform provider, which has different actors around it. There is a demolition company which needs to do urban mining, and the stuff that he mines needs to be, provided somewhere so that other companies could be able to reuse it. So it's a sort of platform is really important in that sense, that there's a party providing that that element in this circular approach.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I don't know if anyone wants to add something about the actors involved, because I think there's of course installation companies, contractors, municipalities, the usual suspects.
Yeah, nothing to add here.
Yeah,
I guess.
Yeah, we can basically discuss the main actors. Yeah, there are many players involved in all project phases, but when you're presenting, you can just talk about the main ones. So
yeah,
that's really enough for now.
Yeah, I think that for us, the main one was then the circular platform provider and the demolition company, the urban mining company that's connected to it, so that these materials can be used to build circular new buildings.
Mm-hmm.
Another important one was the companies who design for disassembly. So when you design a new building, that the entire building could be disassembled when it reaches its end of life. So as a designer and builder, you already need to think of the closing phase, basically.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, I think, a really important one as well, which also comes together on this platform, because how do you find the suppliers that that have these disassembly materials? I think another one which was discussed a lot, maybe Simon, you can explain this one better, was the TCO and LCA, just the life cycle analysis.
Yeah, is it a technology?
As a strategy, I think.
Yeah, from what I've heard, it's mostly about looking at construction over a whole life cycle. So maybe initially the costs to construct are higher, but when your revenue,
spread along the lifetime.
Yeah.
Restwaarde.
Yeah, your restwaarde. Yeah, I don't know the English word for it. When that is higher at the end of the whole project, then it's still profitable to construct in that way.
Mm-hmm.
And the other side of it was that in the end it should reduce CO2 emissions.
Mm-hmm.
That's another strategy.
Yeah.
So that in the end, yeah, you emit less.
Yeah.
And I think a third one to add that we added to that was the prestatiecontractor, so or as a service. So we named a couple examples of Philips. So Philips doesn't sell verlichting, but sells light.
It's a circular business model.
Yeah, it's exactly. And in that sense, they also take up this maintenance part as a designer. And it's also something that you see a lot in the infrastructure. So if you only design a tunnel, you can use cheap materials which need a lot of maintenance along its life cycle. But when you also, when you not only do design, but you also do maintenance, you will choose for different materials so that your maintenance process is better and lower. And in that sense, and this whole life cycle approach, which starts from the designer, is important and starts with these contracts that you set up.
We ran out of time, so we should really go fast for the others as well.
Okay, then I'll do the last one very quickly. We had a few important ones. The BIM and the material passport were very important for us when constructing in relation to profitability and in relation to CO2 emissions. Contract as a service, we didn't know what kind of technology that was or whether it's a technology coupled to it, but we thought it was very important. Mm-hmm. And again, the LCA, TCO, when measuring your emissions in the future, and also and that is for you as an owner, but also for the constructors, the builders, the material suppliers. That's a very important technology to interconnect all the to connect all the emissions throughout the whole life cycle of a project.
Yeah,
so I guess that's it.
Thank you so much for your input, and let's move on to the second group, maintenance group, who wants to tell a few words about their discussion. Second group.
We didn't really have a long discussion because, as you see, we have a lot of cards. We had a little discussion, especially at question three.
Mm-hmm. But that's fine. Just the main outcomes of your discussions.
Main outcome. I think the main outcome, and guys, correct me if I'm wrong. I think the main outcome is for the social housing sector is especially a people's challenge. Mm-hmm. Tackling certain cultural aspects and embedded working methods. And those need more change to be able to adapt and implement certain technologies and use them on a large scale and make big steps towards circular housing.
So for maintenance, which technologies are becoming more important than for circular economy?
Yeah, I think the most important ones were already mentioned on the blue cards, BIM and BIM / digital twin. I think.
Yeah, these two. Okay.
I think those two are really promising because it's a vehicle which makes it possible for all involved parties to have access to the same information, which is not the case right now in maintenance, but also in development. Mm-hmm. I think it's also a vehicle to be able to make more sensible decisions in maintenance.
Yeah.
And I can ask something about BIM in your phase. Like, what's easy in our step at the design phase, that you start from scratch. So when you start from scratch, you start building a BIM.
Yeah.
It's a lot easier. And I think at your maintenance phase, which has housing from the 60s or the 30s, whatever. BIM, how do you approach BIM for those kinds of buildings? I think that's the hardest thing to tackle for this phase, because it's already built. You don't know what's in it anymore. So how do you figure that out?
I think starting, as we say in Dutch, with the low-hanging fruit. So the buildings which we are able to which we are able to identify as deeply as possible. So that's probably more recent developments or the developments after 1990, I guess. But also with the help of digitalization companies and also like Octo is present here. Also companies like Octo can help us do that. But it's a challenge, yeah, it is, yeah.
Thank you very much.
No problem.
Let's move on to the last group. You were discussing end of life issues. Who wants to talk about the discussions from the third group?
I can try.
Yeah. Who are the main actors? First question.
Well, in the end of life, we had a discussion first. Are we talking about current state or future ideal state? Because in the current state, it's quite challenging. Let's put it like that. But I, you can see that circle there with mainly three parties. We thought around it and centralized a marktplatz, which is in the current situation, how it goes if you demolish a building and whatever can be reused or recycled spreads throughout different places where it can be bought, which is a market. So of course you have the party who demolishes it, you have the owner, and you have possible buyers or reusers or resellers or how you want to call them. The challenge for social housing companies, or the opportunity, might be the fact that they are, well, as Sultan also mentioned, they are sort of material banks. They are banks. They own a lot of real estate, and they're in it for the long term. So that's a future potential.
Yeah, Jeroen, you were a little bit critical about the strategies. Would you like to tell your opinion on this and the discussions a little bit?
Now, when we're looking at the moment at our housings, they are, we are actually only recycle. That is the main thing. We don't reuse much. And I don't think in the future it would be very difficult to reuse parts of our housing stock as we have at the moment. Mm-hmm. We should change that for the future. But when we look back in history, we didn't build that way that we were planned to reuse parts of it.
Yeah.
So the most of it will be recycling.
Yeah.
And then the question was, how do you, there was also earlier said, you don't know what you have actually, have buildings, but you don't know the real potential behind it.
Yeah.
It would be worth a lot to know that, but that's a big investment to find that out. But then Sultan said, okay, there are lightweight strategies for that, but we sort of tend to look at the heavyweight strategies. I think you want to have a BIM model from every existing building which you own with the full material, how do you call it, knowledge about it.
In the end of the day, we have BIM models, but maybe there are some online platforms which provide some kind of BIM functionalities could be a solution for the existing building stock. For the new buildings, it's easy to build.
And also, we can also eliminate 18 buildings which we end exploiting between 2045 and 2055. We don't need models from those buildings, especially
because they're not worth anything.
Probably because they're not going to be there anymore.
I don't think so. That's too quick.
I don't think it's, I mean, it could be, but I don't think it's a sensible strategy for the state we're in. I think that there's the challenge. If it seems not with less potential, but I honestly believe, and we've done some studies on it, but there are lots of buildings who you might not think have potential, but if you, of course, you have to invest in it, you have to transform them. But you could even densify them with wooden light structures on top of it, or you could upgrade them. It's just a different approach, I guess.
Yeah. I would challenge the market to provide us with with sensible solutions, because now we don't have them for a big fraction of our.
But our target should be housings. We would don't have an end of life.
Of course.
So, thank you very much for your time and being here with us today. I think it was a useful session. We discussed different lifetime of the buildings. Like we looked at the new building designs, maintenance and end of life issues. I hope we learned from each other, because in the group there were architects, BIM specialists, sustainability experts from the social housing. So I hope you enjoyed it. If any one of you wants to take the third session, organize the third one, feel free to connect Diane. I think she started it, so then maybe we can come together again. My colleague Peter will post a video on our YouTube channel, Charm YouTube channel, so you can come back to see the presentations and the sources we shared in our presentations. So that's it. Thank you very much, and tot de volgende keer.
Okay. Bye.
Bye.
Dag iedereen.